So welcome to lecture L24. In this lecture what we will do is, we will see two case studies, one on inductance calculation for an induction motor, and second would be for inductance calculation for gapped coefficient reactor. So in the first case study, let us understand how to calculate no load inductance of a 3-phase induction motor. So what we will assume here is, we will assume that rotor speed is synchronous. Effectively what we are assuming is slip is 0, and hence there are no induced currents in the rotor structure, and the flux in the motor structure is completely due to the stator winding currents. So in such case wherein we do these approximations, then magnetizing inductance can be calculated by using a simple magnetostatic simulation. So what is the governing partial differential equation? It will be same, del square A equal to minus mu j, and I have already told you in some other lecture that 1 over mu, this mu is taken as 1 over mu on this left hand side to make it more general, so that changes in material properties can be easily accounted for in the FEM formulation. So remember, J is in Z direction because this is a two dimensional approximation, and hence A also will be in Z direction, right. So and of course then that is why it becomes a very simple formulation in which unknowns are only magnetic vector potential values at various nodes in the domain. Direction of A is already fixed, which is in Z direction. Now let us go further. Now this slide shows mesh of the chosen induction motor geometry. Geometry details are taken from this reference, and we have modeled only one quarter of the full geometry. So now let us revisit calculation of flux from magnetic vector potential, which we had seen in basics of electromagnetics. Now this we will study with reference to a coil in a rotating machine. Now this is a coil in a rotating machine. So this is one coil side, this is the other coil side, and these two are under two opposite poles, right. So now we know psi, flux is close contour integral A dot dl, and in this case it will be AC1 minus AC2 multiplied by L. Why? Because these two horizontal segments of this contour will not contribute to this line integral, because the length vector and A vectors, they are orthogonal to each other, so dot product will be 0. So this we have seen earlier, right. So now here, as I mentioned to you, these two coil sides of a coil are under two opposite poles in a two pole machine, right, and then the flux is like this for current direction shown, right. So now this let us go further. So now remember, this is the axis of symmetry, and this is coil side 1, this is coil side 2. So this coil side 1 corresponds to this coil side here, and this coil side 2 corresponds to this. So now consider that each coil side in the figure is as discretized into two finite elements as shown here. So coil side 1 is divided into two finite elements, similarly coil side 2. So the return path for this, the current in this element would be this, and for current in this finite element, the return part would be through this element of coil side 2. Now let AC1 and AC2 be the average values of magnetic vector potentials in these coil sides 1 and coil side 2 respectively. So now AC1 then can be given as integral ACDS integrated over the coil area, and it divided by SC because we are calculating the average value. So, this is the average value of magnetic vector potential in coil side 1. Now, further, you know, simplifying this, now since this coil side is made up of 2 elements, right. So, now instead of integrating, writing it like this, we can write summation over 2 elements, and then instead of the integral over the whole coil area, it will be integration over element area, and E goes from 1 to 2, right. So, now we can further, you know, simplify this as we can, you know, split this summation, and then we can write summation over individual elements as shown here. So, remember this A bracket 1 and A bracket 2, these are the magnetic vector potentials over element 1 and element 2 respectively, whereas AC1 is the overall average magnetic vector potential over this coil side 1. So, further, you know, expanding it, what we have done? This A1, A bracket 1 and A bracket 2, they are written in terms of shape functions like this, N1 A1 plus N2 A2 plus N3 A3 for element 1. Similarly, the other magnetic vector potential is N1 A1 plus N2 A2 plus N3 A3 for element 2, right. And now we know due to symmetry, AC1 will be equal to minus AC2, because by symmetry the magnetic vector potential here and the corresponding point, mirror point here, they will be exactly opposite in signs. So, then the flux is contour integral, close contour integral A dot dl. So, that will be AC1 minus AC2 into L, and putting this relation, you will have twice AC1 into L. Now, in place of AC1, we now substitute this expression. So, this twice L into AC1. So, AC1 is 1 by AC into this whole bracket. Further simplifying it now, what we are doing here? We are bringing out magnetic vector potentials out of the integrals, right, because only n i's are the functions of x and y, right. So, similarly for the element 2 here. So, now and we know, you can refer lecture 18 slide number 4, we have seen this formula there, integral over the element area Ni ds is simply delta by 3, area of the element by 3. So, then substituting that, then you simply get this A1 of element 1 into area of element 1 divided by 3 plus this, and similarly for the element 2. So, delta 1 and delta 2 are the areas of the triangular elements 1 and 2. So, now same expression which was derived on the last slide is rewritten here. And now what we do? This term we can write as a product of 2 matrices and multiplied by delta by 3. So, A1, A2, A3 row vector into column vector 1, 1, 1 into delta by 3 is nothing but this. Similarly, this expression we can write the way it is written here. So, now this whole thing can be written elegantly using 2 summation signs as here, and remember what we are calculating, this is psi. So, psi is twice L by SC summation over 2 elements, and then for individual element summation over for its 3 nodes delta E by 3 AIE. So, A1E, A2E, A3E, you will get when I runs from 1 to 3, and then you will get this entire this expression when you actually expand this expression. So now this is for one turn, we considered only one turn coil. If there are n turns, and that too if there were more than one pole pair, then that has to be taken into account. So here for simplicity to start with, we are taking number of pole pairs as 1. So then total flux linkages, which is nothing but number of turns into flux, will be given by n capital N np psi, and np here is 1, so that can be replaced by just 1, so it will not appear in the expression further. So n and this psi, this expression we are just putting it here. Now this expression can be further written elegantly as done here, where now this GE, element level matrix GE, is given by this twice n l by sc delta e by 3 column vector 1 1 1, right. So now this the size of AET, it is 1 by 3 because AE is a column vector, AE is a column vector, right, and when its transpose will be 1 by 3. So AE is 3 by 1, AE transpose will be 1 by 3 and GE will be 3 by 1. So product of these two will give you 1 by 1 matrix, right. So now this is over, this product is over one element, and then we are summing it over both the elements. So now if we actually go to the global level, then we can actually from this local element level matrices, we can get global matrices corresponding to both elements together, and then the size of global matrices will be 1 by 4 will be for A transpose and G will be 4 by 1. Now why 4 by 1 and 1 by 4? Because here there are two elements, but the total number of nodes are not 6, total number of nodes are 4 only. So 1, 2, 3 and 4, because 2 nodes are common. So the size of A matrix is 1 by 4, AE transpose is 1 by 4, and similarly G matrix would be 4 by 1. So for this two element example, we have quickly understood how we can go from element level to global level. Now we actually go to the induction motor example that we saw in the first two slides, right. So we are talking of jth phase coil. So there are three phases. So we are talking of jth phase. So J can be either 1, 2 or 3. So now just reproducing the expression that we have already derived earlier, with now NP taken explicitly here, because NP now we are not assuming as 1, there can be more than one pole pair, right. So NP is number of pole pairs, and now this capital N, which is number of turns, is given by, for an induction motor, NCS by NPL. NCS is total number of conductors in a slot, and divided by NPL is the number of parallel paths. So NCS upon NPL will give you the electrical number of turns, right. And here SC, we should remember that it is coil size total cross sectional area. And now this we have already seen here, from local. Now what is the difference here as compared to the last slide? Earlier it was E was going from 1 to 2. Now here E is going from 1 to NE. NE is the total number of elements in the domain. Now here you see this, we are doing it for jth phase coil. So G, J, E is written here, and when you go to the global matrix, A, this becomes A transpose. So A is at here, this A will be N into 1, and this gj, so this you know A transpose will be 1 by n and gj will be n by 1. So again this will give you 1 into 1. So lambda flux linkages would be just a scalar number 1 into 1. So now this lambda j is A transpose gj. So the size of A transpose is 1 by n, which just I explained, and gj is n by 1, where n is the number of nodes in the whole domain, and gj matrix will have non-zero entries only for nodes within the jth phase coil. So corresponding to the nodes of the jth phase coil, gj entries will be non-zero, rest entries will be 0. Similarly, for some other coil, some other nodes, the entries corresponding to some other nodes corresponding to that coil will be non-zero. So, three global matrices can be computed for three phases as I just explained briefly, and then the magnetizing inductance of jth phase coil can be simply calculated by flux linkages upon current. Now you can see here using the formulation just described, we have you know got this flux plot and this the flux contours are you know as expected we are getting. So then the inductance calculated would also be then you know as per expectation. Now we will see the second case study of this lecture, which is inductance calculation for a gapped core shunt reactor. Now what is this shunt reactor? This shunt reactor has a central core with air gaps. So these are the air gaps. So these are, although they are called as air gaps, there is some you know non-magnetic and non-metallic material in all these gaps, so that this whole thing is mechanically stable, and these you know gaps basically are adjusted, the length of or the height of the gaps is adjusted to get a particular value of inductance. Now what is the inductance? Inductance is mu 0 n square s by l, right, because we have seen in basics of electromagnetics that inductance is given by n square upon reluctance, and here L upon mu 0 s is the reluctance, is it not? And reluctance in this whole magnetic circuit is mainly and predominantly contributed by these air gaps, which also I have explained during the basics that reluctance of air gap is very high as compared to the magnetic material, because all these rectangular bricks that you see in cross section, that is a magnetic material, high permeability magnetic material. So if the relative permeability of this magnetic material is say 1000, in a very simplified calculation one can say that 1 mm of air gap is equivalent to 1000 mm of this high permeable ion material. So most of the reluctance is offered to the flux by these air gaps, and hence most of the energy also is stored in all these air gaps. Now remember this, each of these packets, rectangular packets that you see in this cross section, is actually a circular packet, right, like this. So this is having actually a circular cross section. When you take a cross section and look on this from the top, so you will get a cross section which is circular. When you take a cross section here and look from the top, you will get a circular cross section, right. So now the field solution can be calculated by using Poisson's equation in magnetostatics. Now let us you know see the understand the dimensions. So first of all, this you know core packet, the diameter is, this is D, and diameter is 580 mm. Coil depth is 175, so this distance is 175, core to coil distance is 135, core to coil this distance is 135, coil to yoke, this distance is 150, and coil to end limb, so this distance also is 150, right. So now ampere turns for this shunt reactor are, number of turns is 2800 and current is 68.73. and area of cross section is pi d square by 4, and if you substitute 0.58 meters here, then you will get 0.6242 meter square as area. Well, total length of the air, all 8 air gaps together, because there are 8 air gaps here, so 1, 2 and this is 8th air gap, so total length of all air gaps together is 320 mm. So if you just put it in this formula, mu 0 n square s by l, and put in all the values, then you will get inductance as 8.13, but we will see later that this is far from the actual value, because of, you know, these air gaps, flux does not remain entirely within this, you know, central, this, you know, magnetic path. Flux actually comes out of this and it fringes between these you know, air gaps, as well as there is some flux in the coil, and that flux outside the core also contributes to the inductance, which is not accounted here in this formula. I also again mentioned during the basics of electromagnetics that inductance, wherever there is a flux and the corresponding flux tube, you can associate some inductance to that. So this inductance is only actually this inductance calculated this way is representing inductance of flux only contained within this central, this magnetic path, and not, you know, the flux which is outside. So finite element method will help you to, you know, account all the flux and get accurate value of inductance, as we will see now. So this is what the flux solution obtained by the flux plot. This is a flux plot obtained using finite element you know, code. Now here we have modeled only half the geometry, right. So here there is another half identical, but we have, because there is a symmetry, we have taken only half the you know, geometry. So remember, we are actually solving this in xy coordinate system. So what we will be getting energy is per meter depth. So we have to multiply by pi into mean diameter, which is the circumferential length, to get the entire energy you know, stored in respective, you know, parts of this geometry. So now the inductance calculation, we will see how to do. So now we have divided the whole geometry into 5 parts: core, air gaps in the core, core winding gap, winding, and rest window portion. So I will explain you these 5 parts again. So when I say core, it is only this core, magnetic part, high permeable magnetic part here. Second is air gaps, so basically it is all these air gaps. Third is core to coil, so this region here and this region here. Next is the actual coil, and then rest of the portion means this portion between coil and end limb. So these are the 5 parts, and remember we have modeled only one half of this whole geometry, and then the other half we will take care by multiplying by, you know, pi into mean diameter. So that will give us the total circumferential length, because we have to remember that this core, entire core with gaps, as well as this coil, they are circular, so they are symmetric about this central axis. Now you can see here, maximum energy is stored in the air gaps, 1.92 × 10⁴. Then it is 6.15 × 10�³ between core to winding, because the flux is fringing between the gaps. So there are also considerable energies there. But in the winding it is further less, whereas in the core and in the rest of the winding portion it is very less. In core obviously it is very less because the permeability is very high and the reluctance is very low. So the energy stored is very low. For the same flux density, the energy density will be given by half mu h square, is it not? So since mu is high, for the same B, h value will be very small. And if h value is small, half mu h square will be very small, which is the energy density. That energy density multiplied by volume will give the energy. So now total stored energy is addition of all these phi numbers. And now remember, this is the total energy J, because why? We have already the values given by the FEM code were joules per meter in each individual area. To those values we have multiplied by corresponding pi into mean diameter, right. So you can easily verify these are the corresponding mean diameters of those sections here, phi parts of the geometry. Okay, so total stored energy is addition of all these phi. So the I is 68.73, and now if you equate half Li square as this, then L you will get as 11.64, right. And now actually by FEM if we just calculate the inductance by considering only energy in air gaps, which is 1.92 × 10⁴, right, then we get inductance as 8.13, which matches with the one calculated by simple analytical formula, right. But as I said earlier, other four energy values are not accounted here, that is why we get this value much smaller as compared to the actual value, which is 11.64. The same actually solution we can get by further reducing the model. So earlier we made only we basically obtained a solution by considering only half the model. Now in this case we will consider only quarter model, because then we can exploit the symmetry around this horizontal axis in the middle of the coil. Earlier we exploited symmetry along this axis, now we are exploiting symmetry along this horizontal axis. So number of ampere turns, then we will have to define just 50% here in this coil block, right, and the total energy will be the energy obtained from this 1/4 model. You have to multiply it by 2 to basically get the energy for the both the parts, this part as well as the part down, right. And then the total energy that was obtained was 2.78 × 10⁴, which is quite close to that obtained considering the half model. And then the inductance we can calculate as usual, as done in the previous slide, and we get it as 11.77 Henry. So the last point that I want to discuss here is why to have so many air gaps in the middle core structure, why not have one single air gap? That question may arise in minds of those who are actually not knowing the design aspects of shunt reactor, typical shunt gap core shunt reactor. What happens is there are two problems associated with this. If you have a single air gap, of course it it is much easier from the point of view of design as well as from the point of view of manufacturing. But then there are two issues. One is, now you can see the fringing is very high, and the effective length of this flux contours also is more, right. So the inductance that you would get by having only this one air gap would be quite different than that obtained by using multiple gaps. So that is one thing that one has to remember. Secondly, because of this heavy fringing flux, that flux hits this winding portion, winding area, particularly the middle of the winding. Can you see here? There is a heavy flux which is incident on this winding area that can cause excessive eddy current losses and hot spot, and that can even damage this winding within no time. So that is why we should have multiple air gaps which are of smaller heights, so that you can avoid all such quality problems, and you can estimate the inductance also quite accurately get the value within the expected range. Thank you.